When you think about humility, what comes out, and probably one way of defining this is to look at the opposite, which is pride. And pride is the one that tells us that no one should be better than you. Or when we see someone advancing, we think, why are they advancing and I'm not? No one should be better than you. You're always thinking about yourself more than you think about other people. And of course, again, at the center of pride is that self-centeredness, where it's all about me. And I am the benchmark. I am the end goal here. So whatever I do, if it costs for me to serve others, I won't, because it's not serving me. So humility is not thinking less. It's not saying, oh, I'm this person. I don't have any, you know, any identity. I don't have, you know, the way, you know, people kind of look less on themselves. No, it's not that kind of a thing. It's not saying I am this person who, you know, if I may use, who is rubbish and stuff like that. No, it's actually thinking of yourself less. It's saying I will do this thing not for myself, but for someone else. So in that sense, you're moving that service from yourself to someone else. And we start these verses with this whole phrase that in the same way. And the question I've asked there is, which way? And we have just looked at the first four verses of chapter 5, which Pastor Fidel helped us look at. And they are laden with this whole idea of shepherding. And at the core of shepherding is the whole idea that you will not do shepherding when you're self-centered, when you're proud, but in humility, because you have to think of yourself less in order to serve. There'll be call time when you are going an extra mile. And that's what you're saying. That's why Peter is beginning by saying, in the same way, in which way? In the same way a shepherd has to go out and serve, is the same way that the people that Peter is writing to next should think about this. So in that understanding of a shepherd, and you can even think about when he talks about the chief shepherd, who is God himself, and he leaves his throne, he leaves his lordship, and comes and serves us. So he could have said, I am God, why do I need to go down? But he doesn't. So that example of God is the example of every shepherd, and is the example of every Christian. In the same way, you who goes again to talk about the younger people. And this is interesting that he talk about young people, because he has just been talking about elders. And one of the things I say there is, why is it addressing young people? I think it's because they can easily be given to defiance and resistance. When you see the New Testament, and I think that's one of the things I've said there, when you see the New Testament addressing a people directly, or a certain group of people, or a certain social class, it is because of the way they are exposed or have that exposure towards going in a certain direction. And I've given you an example there of Ephesians 6:4, where actually it talks about fathers, do not exasperate your children. Why doesn't it include mothers? Because in a family setting, it is fathers, because they are supposed to be the disciplinarians, that they are the ones who can easily exasperate or actually take it too far and exasperate their children. So there is that warning. And the same here is the same thing being used for young men. And in that time that Peter is writing, there was this acknowledgement or identity of young people and association of young people. And the danger in those associations is that because they don't have experience and wisdom, that there is the danger of defiance and resistance. And therefore, Peter is saying to them, in the same way that, you know, you are, you know, that God has served you and shepherds are supposed to serve, in the same way, you are also supposed to submit to the elders. And this word used here, elders, which could be people who are older in age, but in this context, it's also the whole idea of elders who are in a church setting. And that's a very interesting relationship there, because he's talking about elders who mostly will be men and younger men. And the danger with being young, as you have heard of that phrase, is when I was young, that phrase of when I was young and foolish, is that the danger is to think everything the elders or the people who are older are doing is not right. And probably they, you know, we think that we have a better picture, but they have a better picture than we who are younger could have. And that's the warning in there, that they ought to be careful. They ought to submit and not be in defiance and resistance. And that is, you can almost see the way later on to come out. Instead of being resistant to the elders, they should actually be resisting the devil himself, because he's the one who might lead them in that direction. And I have said there that all, the next bit that Peter talks about there is that all people, it's not just the young people that are supposed to submit and be humble. All people in the community of believers are supposed to clothe themselves with humility. Now, submission is an essence of humility. You won't be able to submit if there is no humility in us. And therefore, he moves from young people and now comes to everyone within the community of believers. And he's actually saying, to maintain a community of believers, there must be humility for everyone. Now, think about it. Think about people within a community who think of themselves less. Now, if you're in that community, if I'm thinking about myself less, that I will be driven to think about someone else. And so I'll go and serve them. And they will be thinking about someone else. And they'll go and serve them. Now, what does that do in a Christian community? It grows and strengthens the Christian community. And that's what Peter is writing. And remember, Peter is big on this whole idea of Christian community. And the way to strengthen it is that everyone in that community should be humble. And we go back to that definition that humility is thinking of yourself less. It's stopping in a Christian community and thinking, maybe I don't have a monopoly for all truths or all opinion and ideas. And I need to stop and listen to others within that Christian community. Maybe I don't need to push my idea that much and probably allow other ideas to go ahead. And he goes on in verse 5b and also verse 6 to show that humility is at the center of the gospel. So he uses the he quotes God opposes the proud from Proverbs, but shows favor to the humble. And at the center of the gospel, that's what it is. When we are proud, we don't think of our sin. We don't think about what God has done for us. And therefore, we don't come with repentance. And at the end of it all, when that doesn't happen, the gospel has not changed us. So we are doomed for damnation. But when we come with humility and realize that we are sinners, and we are looking for a savior, then we are saved. That humility ensures that our salvation, our life is actually saved. But when people are proud, when they think that they can do it on their own, when they think that, you know, they can meet the level of holiness of God on their own, which is pride, then they are damned. For eternity. And I think that's something that we need to carry on as we think about the next few verses. And it goes on in verse 6. I think we have lost Eugene there. Let me try and share the PowerPoint. Oh, he's back. You can share again, Eugene. Yeah, and it goes on in verse 6 to talk about humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Of course, that due time is not defined. But I think what he's trying to talk about there is the fact that in the next second coming of Christ Jesus, that every person who has humbled himself by faith and sat and submitted himself to God himself, God's mighty hand, will be exalted. And that's an important aspect of the gospel. Unless there is that death, unless there is that submission, there will be no exaltation. The same way we said, unless there is a cross, there will be no glory. God will lift them in due time. And again, this is followed by the fact that if believers are continuously showing this humility by casting their burdens to the Lord, In other words, showing dependence on him continuously, then they will know of his providence because he cares for them. And I thought that's a very helpful thing for people who are going through suffering and hard times. Again, remember the people Peter is writing to. They are going through all this hardship and they are wondering, is God with us? And here he's saying, actually, the way to show that we are still faithful is to submit ourselves, be humble, and continuously cast our cares to him. When we're in that hot seat or in a situation that there is a lot of suffering, the danger always is to think, is the Lord with me? Is God going to take this away? If I leave my faith and go and try something else, maybe this suffering will go away. But he's actually reminding us, God cares for us, and God cares for you and for me. In those moments, let's cast our anxiety. And again, it feeds to the whole issue of humility, because when we are self-absorbed, we want to do things just thumping. We want to just thump ourselves and do things that way. But the opposite is true. Instead of just thumping ourselves, we cast all our anxieties and all our cares to him, and the Lord cares, and through him we'll have providence. If we move on to the next slide, we look at the next point that Peter looks at and helps us see from this bit, is that believers are to be alert and of sober mind to be able to resist the devil and stand firm. And I began there by reminding us that we came across this word alert and sober in 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 13. And remember we said, unless our minds are renewed to biblical worldview, it will be hard to fight the Christian battle. Because most of the time, we tend to gravitate towards the beliefs that we have held in our mind and in our hearts, if I may add that. And therefore, it is important to actually come to an encounter with God's word and God's truth, so that the way we think, the way we view the world, the way we think what is important in this world, the way our hearts, the kind of direction our hearts tend to gravitate towards, are defined by what God's word is. And this is what he's saying here, that believers are to be alert and of sober mind to be able to resist the devil. Now, if in this spiritual warfare is to think, how do I win this battle? And the word that he has used there of the devil is also the word accuser. He's the one who comes and accuses us of our own sin. Whether it's resistance of authority, or it is defiance, or it is living with malice and envy, the things that he had been talking about in 1 Peter, or living in immorality. Now, when those things, probably in the past or whatever time they have happened, he is the one who comes and accuses the believers. Now, how do you ensure that you're fighting the battle that the devil is bringing to our doors? It's by being sober and alert. And that means that our minds need to be changed by the truth of God's word, so that when the accuser comes, we're able to resist him. And that's what he's saying. And again, look at what he's saying, that instead of resisting elders, for young people, and not submitting, we are actually supposed to resist the devil. And he is our enemy. And this is a very helpful point to see, that the devil is our enemy. It's not other people. The devil is our enemy. Of course, he can use other people, but he is our enemy, and we ought to resist him. And he's out and about. He's an invisible enemy. And so how we fight him really matters. And you don't know whether he's next to you or in your mind or in your current deal, whatever deal that you are following up. How do you know? It's only when our minds are alert and sober in the truth of God's word. And unless that happens, unless we come to that truth encounter where the things we have learned in years are continuously being changed by the truth of God's word, so that in every situation, our mind is alert and sober, so that we say no when the devil brings it to our doors. And the analogy being used here of the devil being a roaring lion is something that we can actually connect to, because we have savanna grassland in our context. And you've seen those documentaries where lions are hunting. And what they will do, they will go towards a crowd, a herd of, let's say, wild beast or antelopes. And they will single out one animal and they will start the chase. And one, when the herd goes towards one direction, one of them will actually go towards one direction. And that disassociation with the herd means it becomes an easy target for a kill when the predator is following it. And that's the same thing. He's roaring out. So when he comes and roars, the danger is when those who are not alert and sober in that community of believers are segregated, then they become easy targets, be pounced on by the devil. And that's why he's saying we need to be alert and sober, because we don't know what he can bring towards a Christian community. So that's a good reminder there. If we move on to the next bit, our response is our alertness and sobriety will help resist him, the devil. Think about it for a moment. That interesting, I thought about it. At one point, just a few verses before that, you're being called to be humble Christians, and the next one you're called to resist the devil. So how do you become humble and resist the devil? And I think the answer is there, where he's talking about, and the God of all grace, the victory that a believer holds on to is not a victory that is attained by our own works. It's a victory that Christ has attained for us. And therefore, I've said there that this is the attitude we ought to have as believers, that instead of me thinking that I can do it on my own, is to look at what God has done, to surrender to him, to be still in that sense, and leave God and what the victory he has achieved for us on the cross to take preeminence. And this attitude is the community builder we can see there. It's that humility, is knowing I need to be humble, resist the devil, be alert and resist the devil, is the community builder. It's the thing that builds the community of believers. And is helpful. And the opposite is true. A proud heart thinks they have a monopoly, and it kills community. It kills the body of believers. It kills believers themselves when people think they have a monopoly of the truth or whatever it is. And what's our motivation? First of all, we are not the only ones going through hardship and suffering. So that's a motivation for us as believers, that we need to be motivated, that we are not the only one. Every believer in the world, as long as they are true Christians, they are going through one form of suffering or another. And the second motivation is that this suffering has an end. Look at what he says. And the God of all grace who called you to his eternal glory. So this suffering has an end because there is glory that awaits us. And that's a helpful thing to be reminded about. That is our motivation. That for a Christian, this is not the end. There is more to come. And I thought about it. It's so interesting. Peter doesn't talk about even the relief they might find in this world, because even that relief is short-lived. You know, the only assurance they have is that there is glory that awaits them, eternal glory, forever. And we're going to see that. So he move on to, before we move on, I found this helpful quote from C.S. Lewis. There are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devils. One is to disbelieve in their existence. The other is to believe and to feel an excessive and unhealthy interest in them. They themselves, the devils, are equally pleased by both errors and hail a materialist or a magician with the same delight. And what C.S. Lewis is trying to say is, we can't assume or ignore the devil. You do that at your own peril. And the error, the two errors is, you know, thinking the devil does not exist, the enemy is not at work, or thinking or being too overly obsessed. Maybe in our context is an overly obsession with the devil. And we don't see the victory God has attained for us. But on the other side is that thinking that he doesn't exist. And he's saying the devil loves both errors. He loves those who think he doesn't exist, and he loves the error that think that he has the power, he has the control in the world. And we should be careful with both errors, to think that the devil doesn't exist and that he is in control of the world. We should be careful with both errors. Let's move on to that one. Last one is to see that believers are to persevere in the assurance that God will hold them fast to the end. And you see that in the language that Peter uses there, the first, that God has called us to an eternal glory. This call is not just for this world. It is not just for this moment. It is for eternal glory. And we saw that in chapter 1, verse 1, to God's elect in dispassion. God calls them, but they are actually in dispassion. And that call on his people is not just for this world. It is for eternity. And we see that language again in 5 verse 10. And the God of all grace who called you to his eternal glory. So saving faith is not just a faith to save us now. It's also a faith that assures our salvation is for eternity and for a glory that is assured. Which then means when we suffer, and that's again what Peter goes into, after you have suffered a little while, when suffering comes, it's for a little while. Its time is expired. That whole use of the time word there, a while. It is not for eternity. Yet the call we have as Christians is for eternity. So you can compare and say, one is for eternity, one is for a little while. Can I wait and see this glory that the Lord has in store for me? And when we lose it, when we become too earthly minded, when we don't set our hearts and our hope and alert in our mind and our hearts and sober of that glory, when we miss that hope, then there is a danger of us being obsessed, of us being absorbed by the current world. And that leads to pride, okay? And it leads to a lack of submission, because we want to fight our battles in this world and not see that actually we have a glory. And our God holds us fast. And the words used there is, you know, he will restore, he will make strong, he will make firm and steadfast. Now, restore here means put in order. So he will restore everything. He will come and put everything in order. He will mend the brokenness of the world that is bringing the suffering. And that's a glorious thing. If you have not thought about glory, that's a glorious thing. That there will be a time when, God will mend the brokenness in the world. Isn't that the hope we have in Christianity? That there is an expiry to the brokenness in the world, to the sin in the world. And God will restore it. It's him who will do it. So he doesn't just call us for this world. He calls us for eternity. But he also restores everything. And he will make strong, he will make firm and steadfast. He is the one who will bring us up to the end. Saving faith is persevering faith. He will bring us up to the end in his strength, for his own glory. So that at the end of it all, we'll look back and say, wow, I went through that. I was there in that world. And look at how the Lord was able to bring me safely to his home. And that will be a glorious thing. It will be an amazing thing. A time of praise, us bursting in praise for God's glory. To continue to love him. And which then leads us to the several applications as we welcome questions. Applications here is just a reminder that we Christians are people who are marked by humility before the Lord and before others within a Christian community. And the question I've asked there is, are you a believer marked with humility or with self-absorption and defiance? And that is a sign that probably even our own change or transformation is a long way, because I am not trusting that the Lord can fight for me. I am not trusting that the Lord can actually steal my heart and comfort me, and that he cares for me. Isn't that what we are reminded in verse 6, cast all your cares and anxiety to him because he cares for you. And so when we don't think the Lord cares, it's when now we run into a frenzy of thinking that I can do it for myself. And so we on in the process, because it is based on our own strength, we step on everyone. We don't serve them because we think, I must attain this. This is more important to me. So are we marked with humility or self-absorption and defiance? The gospel is born out of Christ thinking less of his thinking of himself less. That should be the word there. And by coming to die for us. So that's what marks, the gospel from Philippians, that Christ Jesus did not consider his lordship as something to be grasped, but instead he left it. He humbled himself. He submitted and came to the world to die for you and me. That's what humility is. That's what the gospel is. The center of the gospel is humility. And therefore, Christians are those that ought to be marked with humility, not defiance and absorption and pride. And then are we those who are alert and sober by constantly submitting ourselves to God? That call there, that submit yourself to the Lord and he will lift you up. So are we marked with that? Are we craving? Are we those who are craving to have the word of God and submission through prayer change us? Again, through 1 Peter, we have seen that call that we should be those who crave for God's word, to constantly submit to him and depend on him. Are we those people? Because the only way we're going to deal with our own pride and self-absorption and defiance is through letting his truth of his word change us. Now, and unless we are submitting, constantly submitting to it, then there will be no growth. And prayer. Now, prayer deals with our own issues, with our own heart. When we leave that prayer room, there's that strong feeling where our own ambitions, our own desires are subjected to the Lord's, and therefore we are able to submit to him. And that helps us, our mind and heart, to be alert in the things that come our way, and even to resist the devil. And to be reminded that God will mend everything. Every injustice in this world will be mended, and he will establish us forever. That's a promise he has given us. And because he's the one who has given, he will bring it to the end. Why? Because he cares for you and for me. And he has called us, not just for now, but for eternity. Our glory is coming because suffering has an end. If you suffer as a Christian, because many are suffering also out there as Christians, that suffering has an end because God will mend everything and establish us forever. So in whatever injustice you can think about in this country, in the entire globe, God will mend it when Christ returns. So those are helpful reminder for us to think about when you think about these verses. And of course, he ends there by reminding the church that this is the true grace of God. Stand firm in it. There is no other way that a people who are going through hardship as Christians are going to stand firm, apart from that new birth into a living hope, the assurance that God will come and mend everything. That is the gospel. And that's what he's saying. When we stand firm on this, when we continuously stand firm on this gospel, then we are looking at the glory that will come to us when Christ Jesus returns for him and for his glory. I will stop there. And I will come any questions as we come to an end of 1 Peter.